brothers, sisters.
À mes frères africains.
Stop tribalism. Stop corruption.
Abat la corruption.
Let's unite.
Soyons unis.
Work together.
Et abat le tribalisme.
Oh, greetings to all. Here within is Nile, daughter D-A-W-T-A of the Wen Music family. So Wen Music is a movement of like-minded human beings pushing the agenda of Black consciousness. And Wen Music means we exist now, music. So initially I called myself Wen Music, but as change is inevitable, today I am Nile daughter, given that my ancestors originate from the Nile, from Sudan. And also, I am from the nation of the Luo people. So all that we say in my tribe, Nyanam, means daughter of the lake. And so Nile and the daughter comes together to just represent the embodiment of who I am and my origins. As a nation of African people and African descent, there is so much that we really are still trying to struggle for, to figure out, to do for ourselves, to push ourselves out there, you know. Sometimes I say, like, and even why I do reggae music is because this type of music chose me. It's not like, because I could be singing any other thing, but it's like, it's something that is within, you know. And I feel like I always have a message and I have something to say to my people, about my people and for my people. I know that's the quote for democracy, but yeah, still, I am here for those that I am. In simple terms, just being pro-Black. Pro-Black is just from the entire existence of self. Being pro-Black from how you look at yourself, how you see yourself, how you feed, how you express yourself, you know. It's time we celebrated ourselves, regardless of where we stand in this baby colonial culture. Because if you check, the Black woman is at the bottom of the food chain after the Black man. You understand? Like, we are down there, you know. And is okay to understand our struggles and what we go through and how we are perceived, all these things, and then heal from that. And that is why I talk about the Black woman being the creator of all this and just celebrating her and what she's gone through and how she suffered from time immemorial and nurtured her children and her children being killed and, you know, all these things. And so it's kind of like a paradox. So as much as there's pain and sorrow and anguish, on the flip side, there's the strength and the power and the determination and the zeal, you know, and the source of creation being the Black woman. Never run away, walk from on your feet and lead the way. Never run away, never run away. Let the Most High protect your day. I was born in a ghetto called Shaurimoyo. And I remember from when I was still in very young, maybe 7, 6, 5, all the way to my early teens, I used to love music from the word go. And it's not like I participated on any competitions or whatnot, but I used to love music and I used to love standing in front of people and talking, you know, and giving my own opinions. I loved the audience. And so I started doing public speaking when I was really young, maybe at around 9 years or 7 years. Those were the days of Saba Saba, of multipartism. And so where we used to stay in Shaurimoyo, maybe what, just 700 meters away was Kamkunji grounds. If you know about Saba Saba times and what would go down, so there was the riots from the opposition. And so I remember there was times we would come like from school and then we are running all around. And then we used to stay in a, like, the houses are 10 by 10, they're very tiny. And so everybody is kind of like comes in and you go to your house, like that. So it was so chaotic. at least every other 3-4 weeks, we would be having tear gases thrown inside our houses. Chaos, people running out. I remember one time my mom was picking me from school and then people are running and she's like, don't be afraid, let's just walk, let's just walk. The police wouldn't do anything to us, you know. And people are just coming this direction that... So maybe starting to see that from that level, it had some effect or some impact towards my understanding of how things were running. And yeah, as I continued to grow and understand myself and the music and the environment I was in and my calling and purpose... Yeah, it just somehow came home. Women are the custodians of a culture. And for a culture to change, then the women must know different and want to do different and to seek different because we are the caregivers. And so if we understand our role and how much power and impact we have on a society, just from breastfeeding to all the way to the languages we teach, to the manners we instill, that also in itself is just a level of political change. We have to revisit ourselves, and by ourselves is our history. And why I say that is because, for example, I'm a child of my father. You look at my feet, they look like my dad. You look at his feet, they look like his father's. You look, and you can continue and go on and go on and go on. So I am a representation of those who were before. Being a female African artist is not easy for sure. Or just even being a female artist in this country specifically, because this is where I work, is not easy. It's not easy. And the struggle just comes even initially from the word go, when you want to say, it's kind of the stigma, when you want to say, yo, dad, mom, I want to be an artist. What? Really? You did actuarial science to become an artist? You know, from there. So it's like, from the word go, you're already scared and have some fears already knew that probably were not even there, you know. But thank you, dad and mom. Nowadays, you guys are my fans. But after so much convincing, being an African artist and being a woman in the art scene is not easy, because there's so much. There's lots of challenges. There's a lot I personally go through. Because number one, the industry is kind of male-dominated. You find people want more than just your art. They want you to offer more than just what you want to give as an artist. People want sexual favors. People want to put you out there. They want you to give something in order. You understand? And these are things that we go through on a daily. And also just finding the resources to just support the art itself. Because art, number one, especially when you're starting, is such an hungry baby. Like, you feed it and it's like, you need money for rehearsal space, you need money for studio time, you need money for videos, you need money for... And this is just an investment. And sometimes you're not even sure if this is going to come back. But because of the passion that we have, is why we keep doing what we do. And really, it's not because of the money. And so you're put into compromising situations of having to, you know, maybe change yourself in a certain way to fit or to do certain things to fit. And so at the end of the day, it's just who you really are and what is your mission and cause and what you are willing to put out there and to give to the people. And yeah, that just defines your path, I guess. Sera zenyu zote tumechoka sikiza. Daily ni uongo kutupanga kadonda. Baza mume seti ndio mukule kabisa, sisi ndio jeshi. Ukora mume jaza midheli sungura. Ukabila ndio panga muko ready kukata. Na dini ndio damu muko ready kumwaga, sisi ndio jeshi. Fire, born Babylon,
Burn Babylon, burn Babylon, fire.
My song Jeshi was motivated by, again, life and what is happening and was happening around me. When I was growing up, Shori Moyo used to be very, as much as it was still a ghetto, as compared to right now, is a whole 360 situation. And to the worse, not to the better. Because when I was growing up, we used to have like basic needs, like there was water and there was the public communion toilet. And we used to have guys who'd come and just collect the garbage. And we had like a space for playing, like a big space for playing when we were kids. And right now, at least 80% of people I grew up with, a good number of the guys have been murdered. And most of it is because of all this police brutality, and a good other half of the females are young moms who are barely surviving. And in Shori Moyo, there's the shopping center, and I know my friends who go there to just park and wait, you know. And by parking, I mean prostitution, to make ends meet. And the rate of HIV and AIDS in Shori Moyo, it's really gone up. And the poverty levels in Shori Moyo. And in Shori Moyo right now, like, even to just get a small space where kids can play, because everybody is also just trying to earn money, so there's extensions all over, the sanitation is very bad. And you can see in the video, like, as we walk through the extensions and the iron sheet houses, and those were never there before. And the sewages that I jump over on the video, you know? So it's sad. Who wants to live like that, honestly? Like, this is a sewage like this, and you have to jump to get in your house. And water is an issue. And even feeding is an issue, you know? So, again, it's life, and that is the life that is there, and I spoke about it in the video. What I do, aside from my art, to push the agendas of inequality and women. So for start, I also volunteer for an organization called SMAC, Sinziwani, Single Mothers Association of Kenya. So what they do, they house young moms between the ages of 18 and below, who got pregnant and cannot continue with school. And so they house them for a period of 1 year, and to just, you know, give them guidance, help them give birth, take care of the children, give them education, and also give them like a vocational training, like either like tailoring or, so I spend a good quality of time there. And then there's the initiative called Wadada Pamoja. And so Wadada Pamoja is just a celebration of young MCs and females. This is back to music again. But young females and MCs in the music industry, and specifically those who are like doing reggae music, you know, because the platform for the longest time has been kept by our fellow counterparts who are the beautiful men we know. And so we're just giving ourselves the platform. Yeah, we do a lot of events all around, and just encouraging young female DJs, young female artists, people who need some type of mentorship, you know. There is a conspiracy against sharing conscious content on the networks. It is, and I would say in summary is like, he who controls the books or the narratives or the networks of information distribution, of course is gonna control what is consumed and what is put on there.
Brothers, sisters,
and mes frères africains,
stop tribalism, stop corruption,
abat la corruption.
Let's unite,
soyons unis,
work together,
et abat le tribalisme. Yeah.
Africa must survive.
Time is right, see you alive. Time is right. Time is right, in the fight. Time is right.
Let us rise and sing today. For a better future, the time is now.